the relationship challenge. And if you weren't here, simply what that brought about, or pardon me, how it came about, is that this is February, right? It's a real yes or no question. You got a 50% chance of being right, okay? It's February. During the month of February, we have the Valentine's Day celebration, which we just took place this past week. And so there's often a focus on relationships, right? Marriage, dating. Some of you are like, oh, great. You weren't here last week. Like, I'm not going to hear about marriage. I'm single. I'm this. And this won't have any application to me. Actually, it has a great deal of application. Because it's not just family relationships or marriage relationships or boyfriend, girlfriend, but how many know relationships in general are very significant? And what are we as a people most dysfunctional at when it comes to doing life? Thank you. This side over here is honest. This side, you're lying. You guys, I don't know where you stand. But anyway, here's the reality that relationships bring a real challenge to that nature inside of us, actually, that doesn't want to flow with God. I shared last week that we had the picture in the Old Testament of the Israelites in Egypt and how after God freed them from 400 years of slavery, he had a promise for them. How many believe God has promises for your life, right? And so he had a promise, but as they were out of Egypt and on their way to a promised land, they realized that though they were out of Egypt, Egypt was still in them. That whole wrong mindset. And so there were things that got sinfully dysfunctional in them that short-circuited their faith and actually kept them from inheriting what God had from them, that first generation. And the same thing happens today. Well, there's nothing like relationships. If you're married, there's nothing like your relationship with your spouse to cause that nature sometimes. Come on, you. It's like when you go across and you walk out someplace and you see like a lake and you're like, this lake is so beautiful. And somebody goes, no, it's really polluted. You're like, but it looks so good. They're like, well, no, you haven't stirred the bottom yet. Because the moment the bottom gets scraped, all the impurities come rising to the surface. And how many know relationships can really challenge and stir the waters, if you will? And so what's at the bottom actually comes to the top. And so marriage does that. It's a great way of doing that. You, of course, dating, then there's family relationships, right? I think I heard someone say, oh my. And then you have friendships, then you have work relationships, all that type of stuff. So the reality is that relationships play such a key thing in life. And so we've spent some time focusing here in particular on what are some of the things that we've seen through the years where we've ministered to people? What are some common patterns or common things? And then what does Scripture show us? All right, because if you're a Christ follower, if you know Jesus Christ, guess what we have a responsibility to do? Follow Scripture. Yeah, Christ. And not only that, but we have the Holy Spirit inside of us who actually wants to follow the Word of God. The Spirit is always willing. It's the, that's weak. It's that Egypt. That's weak, right? You guys with me? You guys, don't get all religious on me, all right? Just, you know, everybody just relax, okay? So that's what's happening. So last week we looked at two things in particular. What are some things that we've seen and what does Scripture talk about? First, we looked at one of the main things that we see in people is that there's just unhealthy reactions. I talked about the Mount St. Helens individual. You just know that if there's conflict, they're blowing up. They're the volcano, right? Nobody sit near them because the lava of their verbal vomit will come off and flow all down on you, right? You know what I'm talking about. How many are like, oh, there's conflict? Oh, I'm moving my seat over here. You know what I'm talking about, right? This person explodes. This is what happens. And so we have people who explode when there's tension, people who withdraw when there's tension, people who manipulate when there's tension, people who do this when there's tension. And the reality is that we need to get to a point where we ask ourselves, why am I behaving like this? And seldom do many people actually ask themselves why. It's always about everybody else, right? So we looked at unhealthy reactions. Thank you for that affirmation. That's wonderful. We looked at unhealthy reactions. I shared even some of my personal unhealthy reactions. We edited it out after the message was done so that no one hears those things. But we inserted somebody else's. But then we also looked at the fact that there's the other thing that nobody really talks about in relationships is that we all deal with the sin of pride. And if you weren't here, you're like, what on earth are you doing right now? But we talked about pride, how arrogant pride is, and how pride never wants to own anything, and how pride is always deflecting the real issue. Pride never wants to own it. Pride will say, nope, nope, deflect, deflect, not me, deflect, deflect. You could do this better. Oh, no, I can't. You've got a problem, not me. It's all how I interpret things, and it's all about my narrative and not yours. That's what pride does. And everyone else can see themselves raising this while I was just saying that, right? But seldom do we talk about the sin of pride, which is listed amongst, you know, like murder and adultery, fornication, all the good ones, right? That's how Jesus listed it. So I want to continue today. We actually had two left, but I'm actually only going to spend time on one today because the more I got into it, I'm like, you know what? We just really need to belabor this, all right? I don't want to rush through 2 points when we can do too well versus too quickly, all right? So what I want to look at today, actually, is one of the things that we've run into through the years is that when people run into relationship challenges, whether it's in marriage or friendships, is this one right here, is that there is an ignorance concerning biblical conflict resolution. Ignorance. In other words, people don't know, or they pretend like they don't know. But actually, the scriptures teach us how to resolve conflict, especially with people who are close to us. Did you know this? Cricket. Cricket, cricket. Did you know the scripture teaches this? But there's some of us that when we run into conflict or tension in marriage, when we run into it, the family or friendship, we just like to be all upset and we're offended and we're indignant and we think, well, I am just so right in my offense because I have not done anything wrong and therefore the other person needs to work it out because I'm going to stay offended and I'm going to stay upset and we've got people waiting for apologies that are never coming. And they don't know how to resolve things. They don't know what to do. And there's this state of chaos and confusion and more just bitterness and anger. But what does Scripture teach us? Because again, if we're Christ's followers, then you follow Christ. There we go. So what does Jesus say in particular about dealing with conflict or grievances or things of that nature with other individuals, whether they be your spouse or your family in Christ or close friendship? I think we just need to look at his words. How's that sound? Okay, well, for those of you who agree, wonderful. For those of you who don't turn away, because here it comes. Matthew 5, verses 23 through 24, and here's how it reads. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there remember that your brother or sister, husband, wife, family, friend, has something against you. Now, if I were to ask you right now with a show of hands, how many know that as of this moment that there's somebody that you know has something against you? I didn't say you had to raise them. I just said if I did ask you. But thank you because now you actually are my volunteers, so if you'll all come. No, I'm just kidding. But see, so obviously this applies to some of us here in this room, but you know that someone's got, you know, something that says leave. What? Leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother and then come. Or then come back and offer your gift. Now, if we actually walk this verse out this morning, right now, across every church in the United States of America, how many churches would be emptying out right now? Nearly all of them. Nearly all of them. Why? Because we know that there are people who may have an issue with us because of something that we did, right? Or because of something that they did. But I want us to look at this verse because it says leave, go. Now, does it say go only if you're the guilty one, right? Is that what it says? Did that come from the nearly inspired version? The NIV? Just playing around. Just kidding. That's what, you know, my mentor, it was my mentor's fault. He taught me that. He was such a stickler for the New American Standard that, anyway, I'm just having fun. But the reality is that, does it say only if you're guilty? Well, how messed up is that? You mean someone could be upset with me and it's all their fault and I've still got to go do something? Yeah, if you know they've got a problem with you, go make it right. Go make it right. Now, this is your brother. This is your close relationships. I'm not talking about someone who's exploiting you, someone who wants to manipulate and control and all that other stuff. You can love some people from a distance, right? I can love some people from a different area code, right? Some people are pretty from afar, but far from pretty. You know what I'm talking about? Right? That's not right. That's not right. That's not right. I'm talking about on the inside. But even when you're not guilty, it says leave your stuff there. So I want us to picture this. That means if I'm a Christian, you know, God's saying, hey, look, I don't care what you got going on, all your spiritual activity, don't try and hide behind that stuff. I need you to drop your spiritual activity and go work it out. Oh, no, Lord, I'm here today. I'm ready to give my offering, God. I'm going to write my offering, and I'm going to give an even extra offering because I just want to be a blessing. And God's saying, yeah, you're still not dealing with it. I need you to stop, and I need you to go work it out. Oh, no, did you want an extra zero, God? Because there's an extra zero. No, I said you need to not make that your priority right now, but you need to go make it right. Pastor Chris, you're a pastor. Pastors don't talk like that. No, I'm a biblical pastor, so I preach the word. And that's what the word says. Before you write your zero, go work it out. Go seek to work it out. But, oh, you know, now I'm just, you know, I'm just serving in God's house today, you know, and I'm just, you know, this is my service to the Lord. This is, I love my church, and I'm serving, and I got to do this, and nobody does it like I do it, and I'm just, Lord, I'm serving you, God, and this is my work of service. No. Leave your work of service and go try and make it right. No, God, I'm serving you. I'm serving you. Oh, Lord, no, now I'm worshiping you. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King, seated in majesty. God said, look, take those hands, put them down. Use them like this, and now go walk, go work it out. Don't try and hide behind all your spiritual calisthenics and jumping jacks. It's all God's children singing. No, I know what they're singing. You need to go work it out. I'm God. I hear it all. I know what they're singing. Go do something about it. But Lord, this is my personal time. This is between you and me. This is my worship time, God. No, you need to look to your spouse right there on your left because it's very personal with them. And until you get that personal worked out, don't try and spiritually hyper get this thing all, well, this is my personal time. No, all that is, you're hiding behind vocabulary and just hyper religiosity. Work your stuff out. I'm a pastor. I tell you the stories. People screaming and yelling at each other. It's just at almost ready to draw and roll up the sleeves and fist fight. But they get in here. You are the risen King. Oh, he's seated. Isn't he seated? He's seated. Seated in majesty. Oh, can we improvise that last part? You are, oh, come on. Let's go on. Come on. Your name, be quiet, is victory. You get on my nerves all the time, can't you see? God's like, you don't go hide behind that stuff. When the word comes, it's got to have a practical outflow. Leave your gift. Go try and reconcile. What if they don't receive it? Go try and reconcile. Just be responsible for you. Because wherever you go, you take you with you. Okay? But why? Now, you sit here like, Pastor Chris, okay, that's great. That's what God's word says. But has anybody ever asked why? Why does God ask us to be the ones to leave our gift? Why does God want us to initiate if there's offense or something? Why does God want us to initiate reconciliation? Anybody ever ask why? Well, I do. Why? Why would God have us do that? If you're a Christ follower, why would God have you do that? Well, I think that's a fantastic question. And so for that, I need two volunteers. Do I have any volunteers here this morning? Did we get the two volunteers? There we have one, yes. Michael Ripped and Kana. Rob Adams. All right, come on up. Yes. All right. Rob, I'm going to have you sit in this seat facing that way, staring awkwardly at Rick. Mike, I want you sitting here facing this way. So I'm going to get into this in just a second, but why? Why does God have us initiate, if you're a Christ follower, why would God have you initiate reconciliation? 2 Corinthians 5:21, the Apostle Paul writes, Jesus, he who knew no sin, became sin or a sin offering for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. That Jesus died, suffered, rose, so that we might become the righteousness of God through faith in him. All right? So let's illustrate this. Why do you bring that verse in, Pastor Chris? It seems like you're trying to put a square into a round hole. No, I'm going to show you this. Why? Why does God have us initiate? Everyone say initiate. Okay, why does God have us initiate? Well, I want us to think about this. In that verse I just shared, here you have the Lord on his throne. This is God, just for up here. Don't play the God card with Tracy and Matthew at the house. Yeah, you know, I know Tracy, she would knock you around, wouldn't she? There's a reason you're ripped. You got to stay up, man. Anyway, listen. So you have God on his throne. He who knew no sin became a sin offering for us that we might become the righteousness of God. So God is sitting on his throne, but we've got a problem because there's this great large chasm between God and man. And man is over here. Man, we have our back to God. Rob's an improviser. I knew this would happen. We have our back to God. Man does not care that his sin has separated him from God. In fact, man is even inclined towards God. We've got our back on God in rebellion. How many here remember, if you have given your life to Christ, how many remember this time in your life when you walked in sin and unrighteousness and you were a slave to the sinful nature inside of you? I sure do. I remember God wasn't even on my radar. My back was to God. But we have a problem here because there is a great chasm between God and man. And here is God on his throne in holiness. Holiness, the absolute perfection, nothing like God, purity. And God in his holiness can have no fellowship with sin. And so here sits man in his sin with no ability to have fellowship with God and with a complete back turned towards God. God's seated in his holiness. His holiness says, I can have no relationship with man. But then God is also seated in his righteousness. And his righteousness says that sin is a crime against me. And so because of his righteousness, he's saying, guess what? There needs to be a penalty for sin. There needs to be a punishment for the sin of my creation, the sin of mankind. This is part of the problem we're presented with. How does this tie into reconciliation, Pastor Chris? I don't understand. We'll get there. But so here's God completely in holiness and splendor. Here's God in his righteousness, nothing like him. Sin demanding a punishment, and we have got this chasm between God and man. We've got an issue. But there's another part of God. There's a part of God that is patient or long-suffering. There's a part of God that is kind. There's a part of God that hopes all things and believes all things. There's a part of God that does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. There's a part of God that is long-suffering and that is looking and hoping. And this part of God is love. And so though God is holy and though God is righteous, he is also love. And so love is working in God. He is love. And love is saying, we're going to come up with a plan. We are going to come up with a plan that satisfies my holiness and allows me to have fellowship with man. We're going to come up with a plan that satisfies the payment required by my righteousness. And so God is sitting here with a heart towards man, not easily provoked, not easily angered, and he is looking and longing for his creation while his creation wants nothing to do with him and sins against him. while this great chasm exists, God is holy and God is righteous, but then something worked within the Father, and it is love. And the Bible says that Jesus was the lamb slain before the foundation of time, so God knew the offense was coming long before it was acted out, and love came up with a plan that said, I'm going to cross the chasm. I'm going to come to earth. I'm going to pay the price so that I can be with man again. I want you to see this, that there we were dead in our sin, and love. Jesus had every right to stay right here. Jesus was not guilty of anything. Jesus had done nothing wrong, perfectly holy, without blame, spotless. The Son of God got up to fix a problem that he didn't cause. The Son of God walked on the raging sea. Come back for a second. We're going to do instant replay. I want you, if you have a Bible, you can look to the screens. I want you to look to Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. Let's take a little bit more look at this mindset, and then we'll talk about why it's so important when it comes to initiating reconciliation. Philippians 2 and verse 1 says, therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let me pause for a second. If you're married, that verse applies to you. It's not the married verses that apply, it's all the verses that apply. You do not stop being a Christian because you're married. Can somebody help me out here? Thank you. Esteem others as better than yourself, but you don't know what they did. Yep, keep whining your song. Let each of you look out not only for his own interest or her own interest, but also for the interest of others. Verse 5, let this mind, over here, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death of the cross. This gives us insight into Christ's mind. Again, how does this come back to reconciliation? We're going to bring this home. Here is the Son of God. The Bible says he did not consider it robbery. He did not consider it robbery to be equal with God. And what the scripture is teaching is that you and I can't see it, but in heaven, Jesus is glorified like we have no concept of glory. He is on his throne, and angels crying out in holiness. And the Bible says even the pillars, the foundation of heaven, shakes at the holiness of God, and the worship, and the lightning, and the thunder, and all his splendor. And if we could all speak every language on the planet, we would never have enough words to adequately describe his title and the way he is glorified and seen in his radiance and his holiness. There's no way we could even do that for a second. All of heaven shouts the wonder of his name. But the Bible says that Jesus, not for one moment did he consider, hey, I need man to understand who I am. And I need man to understand what I'm doing. The Bible says he didn't even consider that. He got up, taking on the form of our flesh, and became a servant when we didn't know who he was and when we didn't know what he was doing. He said, I don't need you to understand anything at this moment other than I love you and I've come for you. In other words, there was no ego involved for the Son of God. In fact, the Bible says in John 13, it says he knew where he came from and he knew where he was going. And he puts on a towel and took on the lowest form in that society, and he began to wash the feet of his disciples. No ego involved in his mission. I don't need anybody to understand. Why does the Lord tell us when it comes to dealing with offenses, and it comes to dealing with hurts, and it comes to dealing with conflicts, marriage, family, friendships, dating, why does he say to initiate reconciliation? The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, it says, therefore, as ambassadors of Christ, in other words, we are ambassadors of the Lord, we're imitators of God. We need to imitate the one who left everything to come get us. We initiate reconciliation because God first initiated reconciliation with us. Let me say that again. We initiate reconciliation because God first initiated it with us. And if you're an ambassador and an imitator of Christ, then we do what our Savior has done. Let me remind you, he had every right to stay right here. He had every right to stay right here. How many of us so many times feel justified in staying right here? I want to stay right here. I'm going to stay right here. I'm staying bitter. I'm staying angry. You don't understand, Pastor Chris, what people have done. Well, you know what happens? We have Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross and scorned its shame. When we walk through life and we look at what other people have done and we focus on what other people have done, then we will stay in our bitterness and we will stay in our anger. But there's a reason God says, have the same mind that was in Christ. Don't look at what people have done. Turn and look to the one. Turn and look to the love of God, because that love and that grace and that mercy is what gives you strength to do this. Otherwise, we just stay locked in and locked down. We're all bolted up. Do you know, when I say that I don't want to go, when I say I don't want to initiate any sort of forgiveness, I don't want to try and make this right, do you know what I'm saying at that moment? You know what, Lord? I'm going to do what you didn't. I'm going to stay right here. Because in all reality, what I'm saying by staying in my bitterness is that I am greater than the Son of God himself who left the throne. I'm not leaving my spot. Let me say that again. I'm not doing it. I'm staying right here. Pride, 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 pride. But have the same mind that was in Christ Jesus, who got up. Too many of us look at what other people have done, and we don't look to the Son and his love that got up and compels us. Amen. Thank you guys for being great demonstrators. But yet I find sometimes when I'm talking about people who love God and praying with them and talking with them about marriage, I'm like, well, have you gone to them? Or are you trying to work it out? Why would I do that? Christian, right? Remember what Jesus said? Sometimes I need to be asking for forgiveness literally as I'm thinking about it. Remember what Jesus said? Yeah, he said, why don't you want to do what the Word says? Well, you don't understand. Stop it. Who did you call upon? Who saved you? Who redeemed you? Who left the throne and rescued you? Who are you to hold on to that? How many of us have stared into the sin of adultery? How many of us have stared into betrayal? How many of us have stared into things that hurt? I'm talking about that hurt. There's a reason they're called offenses. It's because they hurt. How many of us have had tears? How many of us have broken down? How many of us have felt the pain? How many of us have wanted to withdraw because of what has happened? And I'm telling you, the more you stay here and you miss here, you're missing your strength and your source. We forget, we're very ignorant at times of what Jesus said. Leave your gift and seek to make it right. Leave your gift of seed to make it right. On this, this will be our last verse, but I'm going to give it to you from 3 John, verses 2 through 4, because there's something very beautiful about God's word and how it comes to us and what we're to do with it. 3 John, verses 2 through 4, it says, "Beloved," this is the Apostle John, he's writing to a man named Gaius. He says, "Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. For I rejoiced greatly when brethren came and testified of the truth that is in you, just as you walk in the truth." In verse 4, "I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth." I have no greater joy. I have no greater joy than to hear my children walk in truth. What is he saying here? He's saying, Gaius, I know you have a belief statement. I know you believe right. You believe in God the Father, maker of the heavens and earth. You believe in Jesus Christ, his only son, from a virgin birth. You believe in the Holy Spirit. You believe in the resurrection from the dead. Awesome. You believe in the saints' communion. You believe in God's holy church. You believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You believe in water baptism as a public statement of affirmation. You believe in a God who heals. All of that's wonderful, but here's what I really, really love. You not only believe it, but you actually walk it out. The Bible says in James that those who hear the word and don't do the word are like those who actually look in the mirror and walk away and forget what they look like. He says, but you actually walk it out. I have no greater joy than to know my children are actually walking in the truth. And so my question to you is, as a Christian and Christ follower, We have a spirit, yeah, but we also have a soul, mind, will, and emotions. And I shared with you before that when we deal with offenses and things like that, it hurts. Come on, how many know it smarts? You can raise your hands on that one. Yeah, come on, you feel the pain. It's real. We're not getting around that. But when we walk through those moments, that pain has the ability to try and rise up and have our emotions kind of call the shots on what's going to happen with our life. But let me tell you a profound truth about being a Christian. You're no longer a slave to your sinful nature. Your servants are not masters, but your emotions are not masters, they're servants. Pain is real, hurt is real. But as a Christian, there's something far more profound in my life. It's called truth. And John said, "I have no greater joy than to know that my children are walking in the truth." So when we deal with conflict and we deal with things and Jesus says, I need you to get up and I need you to go make it right, we're not only imitating him, he's saying, what's your priority? Is it how you feel or is it the truth? Because what you prioritize will be the lens through which you see things. As a Christ follower, I believe that my marriage is supposed to do well. I believe that there's supposed to be forgiveness and healing. I believe that. I believe in my relationships. I believe in doing everything I can to make everything right. I believe in that. Those are truths. That's scripture. And there will come times where you feel you're torn up inside and there's things happening, but you have to ask yourself, am I going to follow my emotions or am I going to follow the truth? I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in the truth. As a Christian, we are more committed to truth than we are to our emotions. And so I know if there's an issue with my wife or my wife has an issue with me, I know that what's happening is not the pain of the moment. I can't focus on that, but I have to focus on truth. And what is the truth? God's called for forgiveness. God's called for love. God's called for us working and wrestling this thing out. I'm here to tell you that what happens inside of you as a Christ follower, it's your job to wrestle until you work it through. Pastor Chris, that sounds like works. No, you need to wrestle with God's word in your mind and in your heart, in your soul, and in your emotions. It's not for when you feel great. It's for when it stinks. It's for when it's hard. The only opportunity you get a chance, or the only time you get a chance to show forgiveness is when something needs to be forgiven. Radical, right? That means someone needs to have done something to you. Something needs to have happened. There's your opportunity. The music's not playing, though it is now. Maybe not a lot of people around cheering you on, but if you're a Christ follower, what are you committed to following? The truth or how you feel? Here's the truth that Jesus wants my relationships to do well. And in my response to Christ, I'm more committed to that. I'm more committed to the grace of God that was demonstrated when he got up. I'm more committed to the forgiveness that comes through the blood of Jesus Christ than I am to the offense and the wrongdoing, because he got up and fixed something that wasn't even his fault. And if he did it, by his Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. I have his Spirit inside of me, and if he did it, so can I. So can you. Amen? How many are tired of having your emotions call the shots? Let's just be honest. And let me tell you what, your emotions are there and they're a servant. Some of you have had some real wrongs done to you. I'm not going to deny that. But you can wallow in the hurt, or you can focus on what Christ has done for you. Some of you have some things that sting deep, and daily you see their reminders. And I just want to remind you, you are not a slave to fear. You are not a slave to offense. You're a child of God. You have received the Spirit by which you cry, Abba, Father. You don't have to be chained down. You're set free in Jesus Christ. Just bow your heads right now. Father, I just thank you right now in Jesus' name.